Everyone in journalism knows the name of Seymour Hersh. When it comes to investigative reporting, the Pulitzer Prize-winning Hersh is a legend. Over a career spanning more than five decades, he's broken story after story. The My Lai massacre during the Vietnam War, the Abu Ghraib torture scandal during the Iraq War. And in recent years, he's done some pretty controversial reporting on Syria too. He's now written his memoir, aptly called Reporter. Seymour Hersh, thanks for joining me on Upfront. Your new book, Reporter, a Memoir, is the story of one of the world's most impressive careers in investigative journalism. Your writing, I think it's fair to say, has helped change history. It's sent people to prison. It's won you lots of awards. It's generated a lot of controversy. So which story that you broke over the past 50 years do you believe was the most important story, the most consequential story?
I love all my children. Come on, I can't make this. I don't make those differentiations.
One must stand out.
Well,
really,
the one, when you obviously, the one that put me on the map was My Lai. I'd been in the business for 8 or 9 years. I'd been a police reporter in Chicago.
And yet you write, you say that it didn't really change things. You acknowledge that at the time.
I had hopes, you know, but did I think that the war would end and everybody would declare, we're not going to do this anymore, we're not going to go and...
No, it wouldn't happen on the basis of even, no matter how big the story. You've been in journalism for over 50 years. You've now written this memoir. Does it frustrate you at all that you seem to be winding down your career at a time when the news has never been more controversial and perhaps there's never been a greater need for investigative journalism, especially in the United States?
I think it's going to hell. Now, what you have is, if you don't like Trump, you read the New York Times and Washington Post and watch certain cable shows, yeah. CNN. If you like Trump, you watch Fox News and you read other papers.
But they're not equal, though, are you? That's buying into a Trump narrative. Fox News is not the same as New York Times. New York Times still does good journalism in a way that Fox News doesn't.
But the credibility of the New York Times, because it's so hostile to him, maybe legitimately, but over the top, I think. They've gone way over the top in terms of, like, writing an anonymous letter.
Do you believe that Trump is so hated and so controversial now that he makes us forget about a lot of the controversial stuff that his predecessors did too? You're one of those journalists who did cover many of the crimes and the cover-ups of George W. Bush and Barack Obama, especially on national security issues. Is that all in danger of being forgotten now in this age of hashtag resistance and being anti-Trump?
Of course, but I have to say, what I believe doesn't matter much. I mean, what the facts are is that we have walked away from some of the problems. You know, 9/11 and the response to 9/11 was completely insane. The idea that you could fight an idea by declaring a war on terror and immediately moving from bin Laden, looking for him, immediately moving into we're going to stop Saddam Hussein because we think he may have bombs. And by the way, one of the things I learned in all my 800 years of doing this stuff is when the CIA starts saying we have high confidence that there are WMDs, remember, weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, high confidence. And so when they say again, as the Democrats go out saying, we have high confidence the Russians actually won the war, won the election, you know, they intervened and that's why Hillary lost, not because she ran a terrible campaign or she wasn't very likable. We lost because the Russians fixed the election somehow, some magical way. Okay. I'm troubled by all that. I want more facts.
The allegations that Russia intervened to sway the 2016 U.S. presidential election, and that Trump and his campaign colluded with the Russians during that election. You're skeptical of both those claims. Why?
I'm skeptical of the Russia. I've been doing this for, as I say, hundreds of years. I have sources inside I can't get into, who know the world of signals intelligence and other things. And they're far from persuaded.
Your sources are great. Over the years, we've known you've broken some great stories with your sources. But the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, the New Yorker have some great correspondents, I think you would admit, doing this work. And their sources are telling them differently. The intelligence agencies themselves are saying differently. Even the bipartisan Republican-led Senate Intelligence Committee says Russia intervened in the election. So why should we believe you and your sources versus all the other evidence that says this happened?
You're asking me for an opinion. I'm giving you an opinion.
So you're skeptical of the intelligence agency's high confidence,
they say
the Mueller investigation and indictments, the emails from Don Trump Jr., all of that. You just don't buy it. You don't think the Russians...
You're taking me way too far. I'm not saying that.
I'm
all I'm saying is that my experience with a community that says we have high confidence is, high confidence to me sometimes means we really don't know jack.
Which is fair enough, so you could say
that's
that.
All
but
I'm
you've,
saying.
No, you've said in the past that it's preposterous, the ideas that the Russians got involved in the
election. I doubt if I use the word preposterous.
Okay. It's one thing to be skeptical, some might say, and people admire your skeptical journalism, and we need skeptical journalism. But let's talk about Syria, which you've been writing about in recent years and taking a very different line to a lot of other reporters who have been writing about Syria. Reporters on the ground, chemical weapons experts, human rights experts, UN investigators, they're in agreement that the Syrian regime has used chemical weapons against its own people, including in April of 2017 at Khan Sheikhoun. You, on multiple occasions, have argued against those conclusions. In June 2017, you wrote in the German newspaper Welt am Sonntag that there was no sarin attack, that it was a conventional bombing raid that hit a cinder block building controlled by rebel groups, the basement of which contained, quote, fertilizers, disinfectants, and other goods. A lot of chemical weapons experts and others dispute that. They say you're wrong. They say you're basically pushing a conspiracy theory. What's your response to them?
I wrote what I wrote, and I'm not backing off it. I mean, they're just...
Nothing in the last year has changed your mind that's come out?
No.
Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons produced a big report basically saying the opposite of everything you said.
I haven't written anything since I wrote the first story, but I was intrigued by the fact that the OPCW put out two or three reports within a month, which is totally against their, it was if almost they were within 2 weeks they put out a report saying we suspect that sarin was involved, which is totally out of line for all of the procedures. I know people who worked in that agency, I know people who are disenchanted by that because the OPCW violated its rules. It usually takes a couple of months to come to a conclusion.
Just to be clear, you think the OPCW are wrong about this?
No.
Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, the French experts who studied it, Hans Blix, who's not exactly a CIA stooge, who says it was probably an attack by gas by the Syrian government. They're all wrong, and you've got it right. It's just you and your intelligence source. I think it was one source.
I had a transcript
of a conversation
between somebody very deeply involved in that operation and higher headquarters. I got it. It was shown to the London Review. It was one of the things that made them convinced that this was a big story, above and beyond the fact that the sources I use are sources that I've been using for a long time, that had gone through fact-checking from the New Yorker for 20 years. Hold on. It's not as if I'm just inventing a new source. I have people I've worked with for many years. And there's a lot of more cooperation with us and the Russians on intelligence. And there was going to be a meeting, a high-level meeting that was targeted. Unfortunately, it's very secret, the fact that we and the Russians still work closely together.
So taking a step back from the details of this attack, a lot of people were taken aback with the general approach of your articles. Even the London Review of Books, which published your earlier stuff, didn't publish the serious stuff. LRB editor Adam Schatz, who you know has done a conversation with you, praised you in the past, said, and I quote, so depressing to see a reporter who exposed war crimes in Vietnam and Iraq become an apologist for war crimes by the Assad regime.
Anybody's
upset you?
The only thing I can say about Syria is that we keep on talking about rebels. The rebels are pretty hardcore, very tough people.
No one's disputing
Sharia law, if they ever take, and Bashar understands that if he loses this war, he's going to be like Mussolini with his throat cut, hanging from a lamp pole in Damascus with his wife and two children next to him. He understands that his father's regime, his regime is gone. ISIS or al-Nusra, there's a couple of other groups that are just as bad in terms of no tolerance for even other Muslims, will take over, which will probably trigger trouble from Iran and the Israelis. So he's in a war to the end, and he's fighting a war against, and the number of casualties on both sides are pretty even, according to most people. Say that's
not the case, according to most monitors who've studied this.
But I can tell you, there's a lot of studies I've seen that show maybe he certainly lost an awful lot of people too.
He has, and the vast majority of the civilian casualties, according to most of the studies,
there are studies that say it's 45-55. I've also seen that.
Well,
that's still a lot.
Well, on that subject, you said to the Independent this summer that he's fighting, quote, as close to a just war as possible.
No, I don't know if I said.
Surely you can't. Well, that's the quote the Independent news. You should ask them to correct it because it's out there.
Stop giving up people.
You agree that it's not a just war by any means?
No, how could it be a just war?
Good. That's the quote. But I was shocked when I read it. But I think many would argue that Assad is the cause of the conflict and committed more crimes. You disagree, but let me ask.
Why, if a civil war starts, is he a cause?
If the dictator is the person who opens fire on protesters, Arab Spring 2011? I mean, this is the problem with you. You do come across as an Assad sympathizer. That's not a smear or attack. You've met him. You said you liked him. You said you thought he was going in the right direction. Do you worry that that may have given a slant to your pieces on Syria?
Are you kidding? I've been a reporter for 50 years and I can separate what I think from what happens. And all I'm saying is from the very beginning, as you know, many of the initial groups were actually, the Free Syrian Army was real. There were a lot of people who couldn't stand him. He had failed terribly on human rights. He didn't do enough on human rights. They had a drought in the farm areas. He didn't do enough. He didn't deliver on education. I was writing about all of this. There was nothing wonderful. He was not popular among many people, particularly the intellectuals. People were still afraid of him. He was a despot. Are you kidding? I just don't think he's particularly any worse than what goes on any day in Saudi Arabia when it comes to, they're all sort of in that same ballpark. And I never saw him as any more of a monster. They were all in this group of people that will kill to survive.
Okay. Just before we finish, you've become, over the decades, one of the most famous, one of the most respected, one of the most successful investigative reporters in the world. You are an inspiration to a lot of journalists, myself included. Were you surprised at how bigger figure you became over the years? Did you set out to become famous when you were a copy boy at the City News Bureau of Chicago in 1959? Did you think, this is where my career will end up?
Are you kidding? Of course not. But I did understand after My Lai that I was in a different position. And I did understand that what I said off the top, extemporaneously, had more impact. And I did do that. I happen to believe in truth. So my truth about what's going on in Syria may be different than a lot of people's truth. War is the ugliest, miserable thing in the world, and I don't think we have a claim to fight it any better than anybody else. That's all.
Seymour Hersh, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you for joining me on Upfront.
It was fun.